Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we will be discussing brachial plexus basics in this video. And I know you have been introduced to the brachial plexus in quite a few areas already, so I hope this feels like a nice review and prepares you for dissecting in this area. And we are going to go the whole way. We're starting proximally with roots and ending with terminal branches, as you can see here. So we have the five main divisions of the brachial plexus, and as we walk through this, I hope you gain a better understanding of what a plexus is in terms of how we start with these five spinal nerve VPRs, and we get to these terminal branches that are going to be complex. They're going to have contributions from multiple spinal cord levels. So you can see that it's going to go through kind of a mixing and a joining to get to these terminal branches. I also hope you find a nice mnemonic that works for you to memorize this order. When I was learning the brachial plexus, the mnemonic was Randy Travis drinks cold beer. So Randy Travis drinks cold beer, with instructors lamenting that in their time it had been Robert Taylor drinks cold beer, and me thinking, I don't know who that is. So I am likely at that stage of my career where you will need to pick a more current mnemonic that will stick best in your head. So always pick what works for you. So let's start with roots as the most proximal portion of the brachial plexus. And it's important to note that these are not by definition roots of a spinal nerve. Recall, those are what come directly off the spinal cord as entirely sensory or motor. So to be clear, that is not what the brachial plexus roots are. The roots of the brachial plexus are the ventral primary rami of spinal nerves C5 through T1. So C5, C6, C7, so C5, C6, C7, C8. Remember, there are 8 cervical spinal nerves, even though there are only 7 cervical vertebrae, and T1. So those are gonna be the ventral primary rami, are mixed nerves, those first kind of main branches coming off the spinal nerve that have both motor and sensory fibers. And you can see that they are here in the neck region, deep to the common carotid. Remember this, there's your vagus right there. And these are a significant size. So we are talking large, very observable nerves. The roots usually pass through the gap between the anterior and middle scalene muscles with the subclavian artery. The trunks are located in the inferior part of the neck, and this is where some of those roots of the brachial plexus unite to form 3 trunks. You're going to have C5 and C6 uniting to form the superior trunk. C7 just continues to become the middle trunk. And C8 and T1 will unite to form the inferior trunk. Every trunk will have an anterior and a posterior division. I always find that this area is usually the most difficult to discern in dissection. I often work from chords more proximally, but you're going to figure out what works best for you. Anterior divisions will end up organizing distally, so end up in distal terminal branches that innervate anterior or flexor compartments. So that kind of matches up with its name. And the posterior divisions will innervate posterior or extensor compartments. All right, love chords. This is where things start really getting interesting. We'll start with the easiest one, which is the medial chord. The anterior division of the inferior trunk will just continue on as the medial chord. Big one is going to be the posterior chord. So all 3 of the posterior divisions from each one of the trunks will join to form the posterior chord. So makes sense that it's going to be one of the larger ones. And the anterior divisions of the superior as well as the middle trunks are going to form the lateral chord. You can see these cords all give off non-terminal branches. You can see this throughout in this image here. And while we are asking you to memorize these specifics for our content currently, if it comes up in other areas or when we discuss a specific muscle, these may come back into play. The chords are named based on their relationship with the axillary artery and anatomical position. But as we typically dissect with the upper limb in kind of an abducted position, as you can see here, they typically don't appear the way their names would suggest. So don't be alarmed there. So you can see here that lateral chord seems kind of superior. The medial chord seems kind of inferior. And that's just how we have to kind of put the arm in terms of dissection. Last but not least are the terminal branches of the brachial plexus, which I have always remembered with the mnemonic MARMU. We will be talking about each one of these as we discuss muscle compartments and cutaneous innervation, but let's review some big picture concepts here, particularly in terms of what they are derived from. And just note, we aren't getting into sensory specifics here. We will save that for an upcoming learning objective. All right, first is the musculocutaneous. I like to start with this one first. It has the longest name. Its name implies that it innervates muscles and skin, and it certainly does, along with all the other terminal branches. Specifically, the musculocutaneous is going to innervate muscles of the anterior compartment or the flexor compartment of the arm, so like biceps brachii. This is going to be the terminal branch of the lateral cord. It often looks like its continuation. The axillary nerve is on the smaller end for a terminal branch of the brachial plexus. It is a branch of the posterior cord, so coming off that larger posterior cord, and it will importantly innervate the deltoid muscle as well as the teres minor. So if the axillary nerve is smaller, the radial nerve is big. It is the biggest terminal branch of the brachial plexus, and that makes sense as it is the terminal branch of that posterior cord, and the posterior cord is large. It has a lot to innervate. You will often hear me say radial nerve equals posterior because it is going to be the one that is innervating these posterior compartments of both the arm as well as the forearm. The median nerve is another fun one, as it is unique in the fact that it gets contributions from more than one cord. So from both the lateral as well as from the medial cords. And you can see it, then it will form the median nerve. Kind of have this kind of M shape right here at the end of the brachial plexus. It will innervate the majority of the muscles in the anterior compartment of the forearm. So that's key here, majority of the anterior compartment of forearm, and five intrinsic hand muscles. So some of those small muscles in the hand. The ulnar nerve is the continuation of the medial cord, and it really does travel a long way before doing much. It is the major innervation for the intrinsic hand muscle. So the majority of the intrinsic hand muscles are innervated by the ulnar nerve, as well as the fact that it hits a few of the muscles in the anterior compartment of the forearm. So minor contribution there. And that is MARMU. Okay, excellent. Thank you for joining me in this tour of the basics of the brachial plexus. Hopefully this served as a nice review of some of the concepts and maybe some new ones. And you've engaged with this in neuro, and we will continue our discussions as we delve deeper into the musculoskeletal content. Please do reach out with any questions, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.